Okay, well, there are two common themes between both of you. Both of you recognize that an important federal institution has been created, the GST Council, and the Finance Commission will have to interact with it or take cognizance of that reality. And the other thing, of course, both of you are speaking about cooperative federalism. But, you know, since you spoke at length about the change in the 14th Finance Commission from 32% going to states to 42%, are you objecting to it? What if the formula were reversed or changed? You don't seem to be happy with 42.
No, Lataji, again, India is a diverse. India is a diverse state. Northeastern region will be very happy if you introduce normal central assistant, which you are there. If you reintroduce SPA, central plan assistant, which you are there in some form. And if you don't, whatever goalposts you have sensed during this period post-finance commission, I'll be very happy to go back to 32%, because my devolution in actual terms is not very impressive from 32 to 42.
But has it increased at all or has it fallen?
If I have to say that it is increased in a very moderate way. But now, the case will Karnataka and Bengal will not be same, because they were not enjoying 90-10. So 32 to 42% is a wholesome gain for some state, and for some state it is a moderate gain. So you have to appreciate the final facts that India is 30 state, is not one unit. 30 economy or whatever, but it is not one unit. You have a 5 sons, all are not equally competent. Somebody is doing fairly good in education, somebody is not doing good. So you have to have a la carte menu. You can't have a buffet all the time, that this is the buffet, this is the menu. So you have to make that positive discrimination, and you have to see case by case. So impression in Delhi and Bombay, we have made 32 to 42. So that may not bring joy to everybody. So you have to go into detail. Okay. So that is my point.
Okay. Well, I think Haseeb wants to add something to it. You were nodding vigorously.
No, I didn't
get that. Mike.
Sorry. I don't think one needs to get into the nitty-gritty of 32-42. What was the basic intent of 14th Commission? I think we need to look at some basic design issues. We have a messy transfer of resources today. Messy. You do revenue sharing. Then, for a variety of political reasons, we got into expenditure underwriting, which is where the actual problem came up, which is CSSs came in, ministries started to get in, gross budgetary support came in. It became messy. And there was a point in time when Uttar Pradesh would get 47% of the total CSS kitty. All right? So there were issues. I mean, since 1974 onwards, they have been rationalized and whatever. The brilliance of the 14th Commission thing was simple-mindedness. Let me forget the expenditure underwriting. Let me just focus on the revenue sharing. In which case, Himanta would not have lost. I also come from the same state, a special category state. Only two special category states in India exist, Assam and J&K. They happen to be sitting here. Assam then subsequently broke into 7, and you know, we had 8 and all. Now, once this expenditure underwriting thing goes away, that is where the problem arose.
But
because
for a variety.
Now, that is what the understanding was, that the expenditure underwriting will go down. So when Himanta says resources were not increased, the total aggregate vertical was 61%. It remained at 61%. But where I am very happy as a policymaker was, I knew exactly what my revenues will be. There was certainty. It was transparent in devolution form. So revenue sharing was there. And there are criteria. Then you will have discussions on criteria. You can blend population. You can do income distance. You can do whatever. All that is fine. What I am today arguing for is, apart from all this, please recognize that now it's not in India which is driven by public investment. Now, and when I said in resources, you're talking of as if Chief Minister will be unhappy. Here is a resource rich state, and mine is his oil, mine is hydro. What does he get out of oil? What do I get out of hydro? I get nothing out of it. Today, 90% of NHPC's profits come from J&K waters. What does JK get out of it? Nothing. Center usurps all these monies through these PSUs, central PSUs, whether it is ONGC, IOC, and whatever. Dividends come to them. Shares are sold and money is made. So this in this time now you start looking at that resource. Royalties, not revised for more than 4 times in 70 years. Why not? What happened to that? Why can't you index it? And what this has resulted in, something which I think is a very, very serious political economy issue, which needs to be addressed. And I'm so happy that Mr. Singh is here. While you are liberalizing India, every state is becoming protectionist. Orissa says, you mine ore, you put 40-50% back in here. Assam has its own issues. Goa has its own issues. Kashmir is having its own issues. So with a larger economy of liberalization, which is open to the world, you are now building protectionist barriers in every single state. Now, you need to recognize that if states have to grow, this is my original point I was trying to make to you, give them enough elbow room and flexibility. Do you realize that today, as we speak, companies and individuals have more rights to access external markets than state governments? Why? Borrowing...
Because you are not a good credit.
No. So let them find that for themselves. There was this big myth that states should not borrow in the markets till recently when states were liberalized. Now what is happening? No crisis has come. Market rates them. You get triple B states, you get junk states. So where is the problem? If the macroeconomic risk of Forex is there, it is for companies, so is it for states. Why have you restricted them? So the point I'm trying to make, if new economy, new India has to emerge, it has to emerge in the states, give them responsibility, create an institutional structure. GST is a wonderful structure. I kept saying this throughout, that India's first genuinely federal institution was GST. We were spending half an hour discussion on Manipur dried fish.
Okay.
You know, and for the first time, I felt very empowered as a finance minister when I was there, that the union finance minister would call us in a video conference and say, should I raise the rates or not? I remember 1991, Mr. Singh was sitting here. All finance ministers of states must have read in the newspapers that the nature of economic regime has changed. Was anybody consulted? Manmohan Singh, who was the finance minister, didn't consult anybody, apart maybe from his cabinet colleagues. I doubt even that. Now, here you are now getting into states, looking at various complexities. I had my views, he had his views, and we arrived at a golden mean. Now, that's the kind of thing you need for policy-making purposes. How it emerges subsequently is something that, as we go along, we can figure out.
Well, quite incidentally. I'll
just supplement Mr. Dabru. In GST Council, if you see that all the state finance ministers are happy, you interacting with everybody, nobody raise any void of dissent, because that was based on justice and equity. We have a clear roadmap. Now, surcharge will be discharged to pay compensation to the state. Now, once compensation regime is over, what will do with surcharge? Even that framework is also been placed. Now, while we start discussing on issue, now I know many things about Jammu Kashmir, and I know many things about Uttarakhand, vice versa. They started appreciating each other points. On lottery, we accommodate Kerala. On tea, they accommodate Assam. So I think Finance Commission has to, at some point of time, evolve like a genuine dump. If you cannot adopt that as an institution, but you need to go towards that kind of consultation mechanism, where both center and state, both will come as a victorious.
As equals.
Both will be victorious. On GST, whatever our political affiliation might be, but we are with Arun Jaitley. We are with Prime Minister, whether I am from Congress or BJP. You will see no Congress finance minister accuse GST Council, no BJP finance minister or regional party finance minister. Because of the very genuineness, the basis was justice and equity.
I just wanted to add a last point. A book I read when I was preparing for this panel, a book of letters written by Jawaharlal Nehru to his chief ministers, by one Mr. Khosla. I couldn't finish. I could only browse through it. But it is important that Prime Minister Nehru actually wrote a letter every year or in some periodicity informing or considering himself accountable to the chief ministers and saying that I did this, I have had a relation with this on defense matters. he is actually holding himself accountable not just to the country, but to his chief ministers and explaining to them why he took a certain international stance. So federation also has that accountability of prime ministers to chief ministers. That's also one of the traditions of India. Gentlemen, thank you very much for joining me. I think the two finance ministers, one former and now, deserve a very big round of applause. Thank you.